you guys stand with us as we praise the Lord. Praise to the Lord, the Almighty, the King of creation. Oh, my soul, praise Him, for He is thy health and salvation. All ye who hear, now to His temple draw near. Join me in glad adoration. To the Lord, who o'er all things so wondrously reigneth, shelters thee under His wings, yes, so gently sustaineth. Hast thou not seen how all thy longings have been granted in what He ordained? Lord, who doth prosper thy work and defend thee. Surely His goodness and mercy here daily attend thee. Ponder anew what the Almighty can do, if with His love He befriend thee. Adore Him. All that hath life and breath, come now with praises before Him. Let the Amen sound from His people again. Let before we adore Him.
Say, let the Amen.
Let the Amen sound from His people again. For how we adore Him.
Amen. Would you please be seated?
Well, welcome, Calvary. I want to read from Colossians. This is 1:3-8. And it says this: We always thank God, the Father, for our Lord Jesus Christ, when we pray for you, since we heard of your faith in Christ Jesus and of the love that you have for all the saints, because of the hope laid up for you in heaven. Of this you have heard before the word of truth, the gospel, which has come to you, as indeed in the whole world is bearing fruit and groaning, as it also does among you, since the day you heard it and understood the grace of God in truth, just as you learned it from Epaphras, our beloved fellow servant. He is a faithful minister of Christ on your behalf and has made known to us your love in the Spirit. And so, from the day we heard... Oh, that's it. That's the end. Sorry. I'll stop. A little distracted. There was a change in the light. It's good to hear the word of God. So let me pray for us, and then I've got some announcements for you. Father, we thank you for this morning to come together and to praise you. And we pray that we would continue to be reminded of the gospel that has come into our heart. And Lord, we pray for all those, for all the different needs going on that you are so aware of, for your help, even in our time of praise and worship of you. We come to glorify you in Jesus' name. Amen. A few things. Hey, first of all, you know, at this point, I'd really like you to just take your Keeping in Touch form. It's in the bulletin, and you can even tear that off right now as I'm talking. Grab it, tear it off. It says Keeping in Touch, because at the end of the service, we really want to get that information. At least let us know you're here. We could pray for you. You can write a prayer request on it. So from now until the time we take offering, when you're able to put that in the plate, please have that ready for us. Today is our annual business meeting to vote on our budget for Calvary and with your Christian schools and the election to offices of this ministry. So we will have that business meeting right after. Also, there's a backpack giveaway. So mark your calendars. A great way to show Whittier that we love this community. The details of that are in the bulletin. So with that, you know, would you stand with us and we'll continue to praise.
Days we all will stand in judgment for every single word that we have spoken. One of these days we all will stand before the Lord, give a reason for everything we've done. And what I've done is trust in Jesus, my great deliverer, my strong defender, the Son of God. I trust in Jesus, blessed Redeemer, my Lord forever, the Holy One, the Holy One. What are you gonna do when your time has come? Life is done, and there's nothing you can stand on. What do you have to say at the judgment throne? I already know the only thing that I can say. Trust in Jesus, my great deliverer, my strong defender, the Son of God. I trust in Jesus, blessed Redeemer, my Lord forever, the Holy One, the Holy One. There's nothing I can do on my own to find forgiveness. It's by His grace alone. I trust in Jesus, trust in Jesus, my great deliverer, my strong defender, the Son of God. I trust in Jesus, blessed Redeemer, my Lord forever, the Holy One.
Next song, a new song, we're going to try this out called God You Reign.
God, you reign. God, you reign. God, you reign. Forever and ever. God, you reign. You part the sea. You say, my song remains, God, you reign. You hold my life, you know my heart, and you call me by name. I live to sing, God, you reign. God, you reign. God, you reign. Forever and ever. God, you reign. God, you reign. God, you reign. Forever.
Take a few moments and greet each other.
Thank you.
to sing the song To Know You.
To know you is to never worry for my life. And to know you is to never give in or compromise. To know you is to want to tell the world about you. I can't live without you. To know you is to hear your voice when you are calling. To know you is to catch my brother when he's falling. To know you is to feel the pain of the brokenhearted, 'cause they can't live without you. More than my next breath, more than life or death, all I'm reaching for, I live my life to know you more. I leave it all behind, you're all that satisfies. To know you is to want to know you more. To know you is to want to know you more. To know you is to ache for more than the ordinary. To know you is to look beyond the temporary. To know you is believing that you'll be enough, 'cause there's no life without you. More than my next breath, more than life or death, all I'm reaching for, I live my life to know you more. I leave it all behind, you're all that satisfies. To know you is to want to know you more. To know you is to want to know you more. All this life could offer me could not compare to you, compare to you. And I count it all as loss compared to knowing you, knowing you. More than life or death, all I'm reaching for, I live my life to know you more. I leave it all behind, you're all that satisfies. To know you is to want to know you more. To know you is to want to know you more. Count it all as lost compared to knowing you, knowing you. And I count it all as lost compared to knowing you, knowing you. More than my next breath, more than life or death, all I'm reaching for, I live my life to know you more. I leave it all behind, you're all that satisfies. To know you is to want to know you more. To know you is to want to know you more.
We want to know him more. Make that your prayer, guys.
among the gods is like you, O Lord. And who is like you at all? And who among the gods is like you, O Lord? And who is like you at all? Majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders. In your unfailing love, you will lead the people you have redeemed. In your strength, you will guide them to your holy dwelling, to your holy dwelling. Who among the gods is like you, O Lord? And who is like you at all? Who among the gods is like you, O Lord? And who is like you at all? Majestic in holiness, awesome in glory, working wonders. In your unfailing love, you will lead the people you have redeemed. In your strength, you will guide them to your holy dwelling, to your holy dwelling. Who among the gods is like you, O Lord? And who is like you?
As we go to the Lord in prayer today, there are a couple updates I want you to be aware of. The information in your family prayer journal says that Stan Foss is at Whittier Hospital. He has been moved to Imperial Convalescent. He's fighting an infection, and so he'll be cared for there. Pray for his family as they're making decisions about his care and just a number of things that go along with that. We also were told that Francis Campbell is going to be gotten up and walking a little bit this week, so that's a praise. So pray for her as well. So we will take these things to the Lord this morning. Let's pray. Father God, we thank you for who you are. You are compassionate when we need your arms wrapped around us. You are great and mighty and powerful, able to do all things. You are the great healer, the great physician. You're our guide and our counsel, Lord. We thank you for choosing us. We know your word tells us that we didn't choose you, but you chose us before the foundation of the earth to be your children. We thank you for that gift, that privilege, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity as a church family to uphold each other, to pray for each other, to befriend each other, to be a part of a family together. We know that this place is your work, that your work done in your way will never lack your support. We know that you have great things planned for this ministry in the past and in the future, Lord. We thank you that you can allow us to be a part of that. We just pray that as we go into the summer months and the backpack giveaway, a number of things that we have opportunities to reach our community, that you will give us encouragement and enthusiasm to connect with people who don't yet know you, that will be a witness and a light in the community of Whittier for you. We just pray that as we also travel, as many people travel, Lord, that we'll remember the ministries here, with our gifts, with our offering, with our support, with our prayer. We know that you don't need our money, but you give us opportunity to be a part of the ministry in that small way of giving back to you, Lord. We just pray that you'll be with those that are struggling physically. Again, Lord, you are the great comforter, the great healer. We know that it's not your choice to see us deal with these things, but that you will be there with us. We pray that as Diana Poor goes through radiation and is struggling with that, Lord, and just the number of requests that are in our prayer sheets, that you will be with them, that you will guide and direct them to you, pointing back to you, Lord, that that'll be a time of real opportunity to draw closer to you. We pray for the Fivo and Gruzer family as they are still grieving the loss of Darlene, and we thank you that she knew you, that this very moment there's no more pain and no more struggle, but that she's with you, sitting at your feet, walking on the streets of gold, Lord. We thank you for her testimony. We just pray that as the family continues this process, that you will guide and direct them as well. We thank you for the opportunity, Lord, to be a part of this ministry, to be in this house today, to worship you, to offer you our gifts of song, our studying of your word, Lord. We just pray that everything we say and do, all of our words, thoughts, attitudes, and actions will glorify you today, Lord. In your name we pray. Amen.
And I'll be teaching the children today in Children's Church. We're going to talk about a man who knew how important it was to spend time alone with God in prayer every day, no matter how hard the circumstances were for him. So I'd like to invite all the children, K through 6, to come and join me for Children's Church.
Thanks, Dan, and thanks for those songs today that every week I share with Dan what I'm going to be preaching on, and he and Heidi worked on these songs for today, and they every single one of them so very consistent with where we're going with this this series today. Really appreciate it. I want you to turn your Bibles right now to Philippians in their New Testament. You'll see Matthew, Mark, Luke, John, Acts, Romans, 1st and 2nd Corinthians, are you saying it with me? Galatians, Ephesians, then Philippians, all right, Philippians and Colossians today. I want you to see something. Last week I encouraged you, if you get a chance, to go visit Stan Foss, and he's moved. He's been in three different places this last week, so you almost have to be current on the day. But I suggested that maybe you read scripture with him. Just go and read. I know Jim and Lorraine Smotherman visited him on Friday, and they read what was very current in their minds and hearts to Stan. When I was with him Friday night, I shared this text from Philippians chapter 1, and I want you just to see these words. This is going to talk about a stewardship that we have. It's a stewardship of all the opportunities, all the resources we have. We have this very precious stewardship. Look at verse 3, Philippians chapter 1, verse 3. This is what Paul says. I thank my God every time I remember you. In all my prayers for all of you, I always pray with joy, because of your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this, that he who began a good work in you will carry it on to completion until the day of Christ Jesus. And I shared with Stan, I thank God every time I remember you because of your participation with me and with us, with my family, with our church in the gospel. Always, always participating in the work of God here and around the world. That's our brother Stan. And to pray for each other is this huge, huge stewardship. Lisa, Stan's daughter, said, please ask the people to pray for Dad and for us, because we have this responsibility, we have this stewardship to take care of our dad until he is face to face with his Savior. And I remember I told Stan, I said, Stan, I remember when for years you and Lee Hardiman and I, we met over at California Grill and we studied one book after another. And I'd give Stan a magazine, a quarterly journal. It's called Leadership Journal. And Stan would always come up to me and say, did you read that article about? And I'd say, come on, Stan, back off. I haven't had time. But he'd consume it all. And he'd consume the books that we read together. So we have this stewardship to pray for each other. And I want you to meet somebody that you've been praying for. Aaron, come on up here. Aaron and Lori got married just a while ago, and Lori, stand up, would you? I didn't give you any warning that I'd have him up here, but that's his lovely bride, Lori. And Aaron and Lori came in for premarital counseling, and it was just really a precious time to be with them. Isn't he a good-looking guy? And he's got all this hair and stuff like that, and man. So I had him up here anyway, in spite of the fact that he's got all that hair. But Aaron would pray, and we would include a number of his prayer requests in the prayer journal. He consistently prayed for, pray for me that I'll be the husband that God wants me to be, that I'll be the dad that he wants me to be, that I will grow in Christ. And this is really, week after week, the things he would write in his prayer journal were just such, it just so deeply touched my heart. And recently he asked us, he gave us another stewardship. He said, would you pray for me that I'll find a job? So I want you to tell people about it. Put that right up to your mouth. Hold it. Oh. Put it right in there like a rock star.
Well, I recently got hired in at the United States Post Office. So I start tomorrow for my training and driving training, so continue prayer that all goes well with that. And I thank you for every one of you who prayed for me on that. It's just been amazing. God does great things. Thank you.
And see, this is something to really give thanks for. And so as we've been asked to pray for Aaron, and we've been asked to pray for our family, each other's families and concerns and for work, and we want to just give thanks, okay? So I'm going to just pray, okay? Thanks, Father, so much for Aaron and Lori. I thank you for their desire to love you and trust you and follow you and to raise their family to know you. And I pray, Lord, that you continue to work in their lives. May they know you day after day. Thanks, Father, for this provision of a job, even in a market when it seems like the jobs are hard to come by. We pray, Father, that as Aaron goes to work for the United States Post Office, that he would be alert, that he'd learn everything he needs to learn, that he'd have all the energy that he needs. And I pray, Father, that he would that his growth in you would just feed everything that he needs along the way. Thanks, Father, for blessing this family through Jesus. And we thank you, Father, that we've been able to be a little bit a part of that as we pray for each other and as we've prayed for him and them. So bless them, we pray in Christ's name. Amen. Thanks, thank brother. You. Thanks. Well, you're already in the book of Philippians. And as we said before, Paul wrote some letters from prison. He was in Rome. And some of these letters that he wrote from prison, of all places, just happen to be some of the most positive, amazingly positive letters and works in the Bible. And this morning, I want to just we're gonna try in the few minutes that we have to look at both the books of Philippians and Colossians. I know it's kind of sometimes a distressing thing when you see how far I am at a given point in the message in my notes, and then you say, is he ever going to, nah, well, you're probably making bets as to whether I finish or not, and maybe how long you'll be here. But let me just talk a little bit about the purpose, Paul's purpose in writing this letter to the Philippian church. This was a church that that he visited because there was no question in his mind that God had called him to that place. He absolutely did not plan on going to this place. He had another idea altogether. But Paul wrote this letter to commend and exhort the people there in the city of Philippi. He wanted to express his thanks to them, an appreciation to them for their generosity. Powerful that he does that. In fact, he says in chapter 4 some of the most profound things, and in chapter 2 about the generosity of this young church. Just amazing things that he wrote to them. Lessons, life lessons for all of us about how God provides and through whom he provides. And then he also wanted to exhort them against the dangers of you may have heard this expression before, but the Judaizers, people who said you've got to fulfill the law before you can really be a good Christian. So the law comes first, and then maybe Jesus comes after that. But he also talks about those who would say, "Oh, forget the law. Just be free. Live the way you want to live." His theme, the theme of this little letter to the Galatians, is joy. It's just joy. Rejoice in the Lord. Rejoice, 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 rejoice. And Paul keeps saying, I'm rejoicing, I'm rejoicing, I'm rejoicing. Remember, where was he when he wrote this? He was in prison. And he's saying, I'm rejoicing. This is amazing to see what God is doing right here. And you know, this was totally consistent with what he was doing. But the first time they ever knew him, when he went to Philippi with this call of God upon his life, and created kind of a stir, he and Silas got thrown in prison. And what were they doing in prison? They were rejoicing. They just having a ball, and they thought it was all over, and God opened the doors and the doors of the prison, and it was like, you know, what in the world is happening? Even to the point that everybody was so shook that the jailer who was taking care of him knew his life was over, so he might as well kill himself. But Paul stopped him before he got that far. Man, just amazing, amazing stuff. So this letter is rejoice in all your circumstances. Rejoice in the Lord in all your circumstances. A little bit of background. As I said before, Dennis, do we have a map? We're all set with our map. And we're gonna take a look at where, oh, there's Philippi. Man, do we have a bigger picture of this? I didn't tell you about that. Okay. Let's see. We're not over that way. Sorry about this. Let me tell you where Paul intended to go instead of go to Philippi. He intended to go. There it is. Well, okay. This will work. This will work. See, you see where Troas is? Right there. Ooh, that's good. I can see that, Dennis. That's good. Troas is right there. Paul was at Troas, and he really wanted to go to the right. Right over, right in there. That's Bithynia. And he wanted to go there. He had dead set. That's where he was going to go. And God says, no. Can you imagine God saying, no, don't go there. They need Jesus, but God's saying, don't go there. And that in the midst of all this, and probably Paul trying to reason with God as to why he ought to go up there, Paul sees this man in a vision. In a dream, and he's from Philippi, and he says, "Come over, come over," and that's when Paul went to that place and this is all described in Acts chapter 16. This was the first it's literally, this is as you see Asia over here, referred to as Asia, and then this is Europe over there. And this is the first city in Europe to which Paul preached. The first people that he spoke to were a bunch of women at a prayer meeting. And they were all gathered together. They were people who were followers of God. They weren't Christians yet, but they were followers of God. They had a desire to know God, and God brought somebody to show them. And the first person that we know of to receive Christ as her Lord and Savior was Lydia. She was the first to convert to Jesus in Acts chapter 16, verse 14. Well, as I mentioned before, Paul was imprisoned there, and he got out and had this amazing ministry, and then moved on throughout Greece once again. And he made two or three stops at Philippi throughout his ministry. Paul was writing from Rome, and somebody came to Rome to bring some support for Paul, some financial support, to bring things that were very, very practical that Paul needed while he was in prison. I don't know if you've known anybody that was imprisoned in another country, but it can be kind of a scary thing when you're imprisoned in another country. I felt like I was imprisoned when I went from Brazil to Bogota, Colombia, and I got off the plane, and it was probably 2 or 3 hours before I could see my family. They were waiting outside, and the people inside took me into a room with pictures only of criminals. And it was really a scary thing to know. I don't know the language here, and all I see are the pictures of people who are wanted. And they took all my documentation and left. And every time they'd come back into the room, I'd say, what's going on? They'd say, no problem. Then they'd leave the room. Very disconcerting. And my brother-in-law, who's a missionary, was with OC International, who we support, when Steve was... went back to Bogota, Colombia on one occasion, ahead of his family. He was involved in an accident. Somebody who was crazy literally jumped out in front of his car. Steve picked him up, took him to a hospital, and as soon as he finally found a hospital that would take him, the police finally came and to the hospital and took Steve away. And they took him to a prison, and he's in a Colombian prison. And fortunately, somebody knew where he was, and they were able to bring him what he needed until things were settled, and he was able to get out of prison. Well, it can be a scary thing. So Paul was ministered to even when he's miles and miles and miles away. He's in Rome, and he's in prison, and this man, Epaphroditus, came to him from Philippi. He came with gifts. He came with things that were necessary, and he came to be like an extension of this body, an extension of the body there at Philippi. Paul had led these people to Christ, had nurtured them, and now they were coming to minister to his needs. And in Philippians chapter 2, Paul said this was such a wonderful, amazing gift. It was great to have Timothy come, and it was great to have Epaphroditus come, and they ministered to my needs on your behalf. And now you've heard that Epaphroditus is sick, and he is sick, and he almost died. And I know your hearts are just... you're just melting inside. Thanks so much for these gifts. Well, some highlights in the book of this little letter of Philippians. First of all, Paul says, I'm thankful every time I remember you. Thankful every single time I remember you. We've read that. In verses chapter 1, verses 12 to 18, and you'll just have to maybe take some quick notes on this. Paul talks about tough circumstances, and saying that tough circumstances can actually result in the progress of the gospel. Imagine the toughest circumstances you could possibly be in. I don't know what it might be today, you know. Having a flat tire. No, that wouldn't be so tough. Maybe something physical. Maybe something with your family. Seems like where the bottom falls out, you know, financially or with regard to the loss of a job. Maybe a child one of your children who's an adult and the family, their family is having marital struggles or problems with their children, their own children. Whatever the difficult circumstances, Paul said, in these tough circumstances, please understand, Christ is being made known. What's he talking about in chapter 1? He's talking about every day they keep bringing guards, and these guards get stuck guarding me. They're chained to me. So he says all over the, in chapter 1, he says all over the Praetorian Guard, people are coming to Christ, and they take Jesus out of the jail cell here, and they take him to their families. And surprise! Surprise! Is God at work inside a prison with the heavy hand of the law upon you? Of course. Who are we dealing with? He is the Almighty God. No problem here. And Christ is being made known. Sometimes we think, and I don't know where it will go. You think of our brother Stan, who, Stan used to be, he and Bill, every single Sunday, Monday, and Tuesday would go out and visit the shut-ins. You think Stan ever wanted to be a shut-in? No. Never. He had designs as to how he, probably in his mind, as to how he would spend his last days. Can God be glorified in the midst of this? Is God being glorified in the midst of all this? Is God being made known among his people and among those who don't know him? In so many ways, none of us could imagine. God is honored and made known. Paul talks about, you know, in chapter 1, verses 20, 21, 22, 23. In those verses, he talks about, even if I die here in prison, it's okay. Guess where I am? I can't lose. They keep bringing the audience to me, but if I die here, verse 21, for me to live is Christ, to die is gain. Now, it may be better for you for a period of time that I live on, but this is all in his hands. Oh, it's powerful. There's so many powerful statements here. In chapter 2, the theme, Mr. Ely, our superintendent here at Whittier Christian Schools, and I worked together on a theme for the school and church, and we're going to talk, it will come from Philippians chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. And essentially, the school theme will be putting others first. Putting others first. And then right on the heels of those words in verses 2 and 3, Paul says, thinking about putting others first, have this attitude in yourselves, which is also in Christ Jesus, who although being God, he did not regard equality with God as something to be grasped, but he emptied himself, he humbled himself, and became obedient to the point of death, even death on the cross, for you and for me. Talk about putting others first. In chapters 2, verses 19 and through 30, here is where Paul talks about Timothy and Epaphroditus. And then, as we sang that song, to know you is to want to know you more, chapter 3, verses 1 to 11, Paul describes his spiritual credentials, and he was basically said, I was putting my confidence in my own spiritual credentials. I was buffing my nails, thinking I'm so much better, popping my suspenders. I am so much better than everybody else. I'll be able to stand before God and say, I'm here because of my rigorous self-discipline. And God would say, that's not what's going to cut it. It's what Jesus did for you. And Paul said, I look at all those credentials now and I think of them as if I were meditating on rubbish or dung, even, the harshness of the word that he uses. And so he talks about pressing on to the goal of knowing Christ Jesus. In chapter 4, he talks about not being anxious about anything. Are you, I could ask the question this way. Are you anxious about anything right now? How about this? Would the people around you know if what you're anxious about? What you might be fretting about? You know, Paul says, don't be anxious about anything. But this is how we have to all deal with our anxieties about anything. He says, by prayer and supplication, make your requests known to God. Keep making your requests known to Him. And the peace of God that passes all understanding will guard your hearts and minds in Christ Jesus. Throughout this whole letter, he keeps saying, no matter what your circumstances, think of what Paul says in chapter 4 when he says, I've learned to be content in whatever state I'm in. Whatever the circumstances of life, I've learned to be content. This is a letter for the church at Philippi, and it's a letter for John Plug. And it's a letter for each one of us. You see, contentment is learned, and it's learned by people who get their eyes fixed on the one who cares for us more than we could possibly even care for ourselves. Philippians, a letter that is full of joy. I asked the question in your notes, how might this letter to the Philippians change your life? Now that's, I'm not going to tell you. You're going to have to figure that out. And day in and day out, or year in and year out, as you open this little letter, have a pen in hand. What's God trying to say? How would I evaluate my life in light of my relationship to Christ? How do I evaluate my life? What do I see in here in terms of my relationship to Christ? Am I learning to be content in whatever circumstances I'm in? And in chapter 4, verse 13, when he says, I can do all things through Christ who strengthens me. What are the all things? Like what all things? This is for every single one of us. It's intensely personal. The book of Colossians. Paul's purpose in writing the book of Colossians is to focus attention on the preeminence of Christ. To focus attention on the preeminence of Christ. Look at verse 17 of chapter 1, Colossians, the very next little letter. By the way, this is an area that Paul actually never went to this city. We don't have any record that he went to that city. About 130 miles to the west is Ephesus, but Paul never got to. He never disappeared. Okay, there's Colossae. There we go. Thank you, Dennis. But about 130 miles west is Ephesus. Paul never went there. But some things were going on there, and Paul was getting information from people that were that had visited or were part of that church there in Colossae. And they were saying things that were starting to sound a little crazy. They were saying, Jesus is good. But we hear about all these other gods, and we hear about all these other traditions, and we want to be... We want to really fit in to the world around us. I'm intrigued by the philosophy of these people that come to Colossae. It was a major trade route. I'm intrigued. They talk about important days and seasons and numbers. I had a person recently that I was chatting with, and he said, oh man, I'm really into numbers. My number is 14. What's yours? Not too much into numbers. But he was absolutely dead serious. And he claimed some knowledge of Christ, and he claimed some knowledge of the scriptures, but, you know, he was blending in numbers. And Paul, in this little letter, he starts to address himself to this issue of, no. It's all about Jesus. He's the one we are to worship. He's the one we are to serve. When we worship and serve Him, we will, and when the gaze of our soul is on him, by the way, when the gaze of our soul is on him, everything and our behavior will begin to fall in place. Let me tell you how the book of Colossians is. It's like almost all of Paul's letters. He will do, half of his letter is pretty thick with regard to doctrine. And then right about at the midpoint, he does this little switch. And he's into, this is how the pieces fall together in the way we behave. If the gaze of our soul is in the right place. I'll just show you, I've used that expression, the gaze of our soul, when it's in the right place. I want you to look at chapter 3, Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. Colossians chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. And Paul has been talking about the supremacy of Christ in chapters 1 and 2. By God's design, he'll say chapter 2, verse 9, chapter 2, verse 9, I know I'm jumping a bit here. In chapter 2, verse 9, he says, "For in Christ is the fullness of deity in bodily form." He is God. And we saw him. And you have been given fullness in Christ. Chapter 3. In chapter 3, verses 1 through 4. "Since then you have been raised with Christ. Set your hearts on things above, where Christ is seated at the right hand of God." That's the gaze of your soul. Let the gaze of your soul fall on him. "Set your minds on things above, not on earthly things. For you died, and your life is now hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is your life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory." When Christ, who is your life. How do you find, who are you? In what is your personal, I want you to think about this now. Now the answer is, kids, if you ask that question right away and you ask it in church, what'll they say? Who are you? The answer is always, Jesus. I find my life in Jesus. I want you to think, in what do you find your life? Now, after our elders' prayer meeting on Friday, every once in a while we go to breakfast, and we were having a conversation. Israel, stand up here. I want you to tell people about, Israel talked to us about a phenomena among, should we say, young adults?
Well, I think the phenomenon goes beyond young adults or student age. It goes into, maybe it's endless. Maybe it goes to whoever has a phone. But have you ever, heard of the expression, a selfie? There was a day when, if you were by yourself and you wanted to take some photo of something that was really cool in the background, you had to figure out a way. Maybe, people made a lot of money on timers or whatever, and maybe, if you were real lucky at a camera and you might get lucky and get the focus, but usually it didn't work out and you take a picture of yourself with a mountain behind you. Well, nowadays, with today's technology, you just do a selfie. So you just flip the screen and you take it. You might do one, like this, or one like this. Maybe you've seen this one. Maybe you've seen this one. Maybe you've seen the one where, in the mirror, they're looking in the mirror and they're doing this one. Sorry, not to make fun of it. But sometimes Becky and I will have little competitions and post it on Instagram, and it's kind of funny. Everett, could you all take your phone out just for a second? Go ahead. Don't be ashamed. I know you got a bunch of selfies in there. Maybe I do too. Take your phone. And if you know how... You should know how. I'm sure you do. What am I saying? Of course you know how. Just flip the picture around so it's pointing at you. Silly of me. You all know. I've seen your Instagram. Okay, so, and then I want you to just, get a selfie. Some of my favorites, though, are like the real crazy ones where it's like this, So go ahead, take it out. Get your selfie. There we go. Don't be afraid. Don't be ashamed. Thank you.
What was that all about? Well, You do that all the time, Sharon.
Well, I'm trying to make a picture of you, and I can't figure out.
Well, you know, there is a point in all of this. And somewhere in the midst of this little illustration is a point. And it is, how does God see you? And this is what really matters, is how God sees us and who we are in a relationship with Christ. A relationship that will never end because I'm one of his kids and you're one of his kids. And sometimes we can let him down. But who are you in relationship to him? This profound little letter to the Colossian church, Paul is saying, this is who Jesus is. Now, if you're going to really understand, I mean, people are trying to tell you, if you keep all these laws, if you are an ascetic person, if you say, I need to work on my balance, and then I'll be, I'm falling over. But if I can work on my balance and everything is just right, I'm centered now, then I'll be the person that will please God. And if I do all the things that will give me, they tell me at all the seminars that I will need to do, all the how-tos, then I'll be the person God wants me to be. A number of years ago, it was, when the movie Gandhi came out, Christianity Today and in all the Christian circles, the word was Jesus plus Gandhi is a well-balanced righteous person. Well, surely there's some things to learn from Gandhi, but Jesus plus Hinduism plus Islam. Take the best of Islam and the best of Hinduism and the best of transcendental meditation and the best of and put them all together and you'll have what? Well, you won't have Jesus. You won't have Jesus. Jesus plus anything else intended to make me righteous will detract from Jesus. And the message is profoundly clear in this little book. And in chapter 3, Paul says here, he's talked about the preeminent Christ. Understand, chapters 1 and 2 are just loaded with doctrine. So profoundly loaded. We need to meditate, memorize paragraphs. Just it's thick. But in chapter 3, he says, if our eyes are fixed on him, then this is how life falls into place. Look at chapter 3, verse 5. When Jesus is in the right place and our eyes are fixed on him, therefore put to death whatever belongs to your earthly nature, your sexual immorality. There'll be no place for that sexual immorality when our eyes are fixed on Jesus. And in our world today, guys, we are all surrounded by it. We are all just victimized by the enemy and by our own self-centeredness. We are all at risk in that area. Impurity, lust, evil desires, put these aside. Greed, and which is idolatry. Because of these, the wrath of God is coming. You used to walk that way, but now you must rid yourselves of all these things. Your anger, rage, malice, slander, and filthy language from your lips. Do not lie to each other, since you have taken off your old self with its practices and have put on the new self, which is being renewed in knowledge and in the image of God. Verse 12, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourself. Again, this is with the gaze of our soul on him. Clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another's whatever grievances you may have against one another. Forgive as the Lord forgave you. with the gaze of your soul on him and understanding how he's forgiven me. And over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts. Don't start with making peace. Let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, the gaze of your soul on him. Verse 16, let the word of Christ dwell in you richly as you teach and admonish one another with all wisdom, and as you sing psalms and hymns and spiritual songs with gratitude in your hearts to the Lord. This is a profoundly rich little letter that elevates Christ, not above who he is. It keeps reminding us, he is, in him is the preeminence. I remember in the church in which I grew up in, the church that I came to Christ, actually, it's part of the youth ministry. And for all the years I was in that church, they had a very, very simple wall. It was a huge, beautiful brick wall. And the cross was offset just a little bit. Ours is front and center, but it was just offset just a little bit. And there were these words that were emblazoned on the wall. And I'd look at those as a young person and as a young adult. And they captured my, just riveted my attention, that in all things, he might have the preeminence. He's the beginning, the firstborn from among the dead. He holds everything together in the universe, this Jesus, by the very word of his power. Focus on him. Let the gaze of your soul gaze steadily into the person of Christ. Find your identity in him. Because that's who you will be if you find your identity in him. You'll be living your life like his true kid. Father, thanks so much for the chance to just look at these two little letters, and I pray that we would, as we open your word, Lord, that we would love you more and more, that we would know you, that the goal of our life would be to know you and to know you more and more, to surrender to you. And I pray, Father, that we'd understand that our circumstances are not the things that need to overwhelm us, but are things that can be wonderful, wonderful tools in your hands. And I pray, rather than be masochistic with those things, that we would just be surrendered to your purpose. Thanks, Father. Continue to work in our hearts today and now, even as we do your business. We pray that you would be honored, in Christ's name. Amen. I'm gonna take the offering right now, so I'll ask the ushers to be ready. And please take your information forms. As you know, we really do love to pray for the concerns that are on your mind and heart. So if you'll make sure you've filled out, if you have any prayer requests you'd like us to be alert to, and you can put that in the offering plate as it comes by. Okay, let me lead us in prayer. Father, thanks so much that we can give now to your work. We pray that you would be honored even as we give right now. We love you, Lord. In Jesus' name, amen. Would you stand with me, please? I'm gonna close this service with prayer, but in just about 3 minutes, we're going to begin our annual church business meeting. It's always a brief meeting. People have had our budgets for the last couple weeks in their hands. But if you're a member of Calvary, or if you consider Calvary to be your church home, we'd love for you to we'd encourage you to stay and just be part of this this brief meeting. Okay, let me pray. Father, once again, we thank you for the chance to get together and worship you in our songs, our prayers, in our attention to each other, and knowing that you're doing a work in our midst, and we just want to share in that with each other. We pray that as we give, we'd be giving knowing that we're just joining you in the work that you're doing here and around the world. And Father, I pray now for the meeting that we're about to have, and I pray that you would be honored. In Christ's name, amen.
For those of you, we're going to do three things this morning. First is the school budget. Second is the church budget. And I have copies here available for anybody who needs them. If you need to look at them, Mike and Dennis will be presenting it and viewing stuff up here. But also, we'll be voting on those. Anything? also passing out ballots for this morning. Let's begin with a word of prayer, please. Our Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for this beautiful day that you provided for us. Thank you for the word that John has led us in, O Heavenly Father, your word. And I pray that as he encouraged us, that we will truly live with him and have Jesus first in our lives. Now be with us now, O Heavenly Father. Send your spirit among us so that as we conduct a business of your church, of the people here that meet on this corner, that we will do it to honor you and to serve you and you only. These things I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Mike Lee, the superintendent of the schools, will now present a school budget to us.
I want to tell you we had a wonderful school year at Whittier Christian. We saw 62 eighth graders graduate a few weeks ago. They're heading off to high school and to points beyond, and it's a blessing to attend the graduations and to see the lives that are being changed. As I present the budget to you, I wanted you to see, though, what the trend is for enrollment. And if you want printed copies of these two enrollment slides, I do have those. I can give to you later. We continue to struggle with enrollment, as do the Christian schools in general. This school year began with 14 fewer Christian schools in Southern California, either due to closures or merging with other schools. So we continue to figure out where the bottom's kind of be. So what you see there is the six-year trend for Whittier Christian for elementary and junior high. The next slide will show you what preschool looks like. Can we go on to the next slide? No, I'm sorry, the first one, the one that shows elementary. You can see that they're all declining. What's represented here is between Maybrook, which is the red, and Newland Elementary, which is the blue in the middle. We actually have 17 students who are moving from Newland Elementary to Maybrook Elementary because we had to announce combination classes. One of the ways we regain our financial stability is to increase the class size, to get them at least to be 22 students, which is an obstacle because that means fewer teachers, and parents generally don't like to see more than one grade level taught in the same classroom. So we announced that there will be a K-1 combination and a 2-3 combination here at Newland, and somewhere between 15 and 17 students are moving to Maybrook to avoid that. Well, that makes the class sizes more efficient. So Maybrook would actually be about 15 students lower, and Newland might be 15 students higher, but the net ends up being the same. You also see there's a decline in enrollment at the junior high. As our sixth grades get smaller, we have fewer seventh graders to bring to the junior high, and frankly, what's really impacting our income is that it's getting to be impossible for Newland Elementary and the junior high to pay their own way, and we're dependent on the other programs to have a surplus budget to overcome those losses. So the next slide shows you our preschools, our early ed. You can see that parents are going back to work because our preschools did quite well this last year, and we're projecting that we'll at least be the same. They're both approaching capacity. While Maybrook early ed has usually been full and usually been profitable, Newland's early ed program has some years run at a loss, and this last year when they hit 70, they began to pay for their own way. So again, it's managing each of the campuses and knowing which of them can pay their own way and the others being able to operate at a profit so that we can all come out positive at the end. I gave you a handout a couple of weeks ago. You can see the staff cuts we made during the school year, the staff cuts we made going into this coming school year, and 70 cents of every tuition dollar goes back to salaries and benefits. And even then, the average teacher's salary is less than $40,000. The starting teacher's salary is right at $30,000. In light of that, we still operated a 5% pay cut that we adopted 4.5 years ago. We just haven't been able to, we were able to put half that back thanks to the elders' gift from the estates, but we still operated at 5% pay cut. We've kept the benefit program the same, but this time next year with Obamacare, Affordable Care Act, we'll see what that costs and what that impact will have on our school and our costs as an employer and our costs as employees. Because we continue to maintain two campuses, we have two school offices and probably more administrators than we need, but we are confined to having two campuses, and I can talk to you about that later. It's a complicated process of looking at why we have two campuses. We're not anticipating any new curriculum expenses, so you can go to the income and then now to the expenses. We don't anticipate any new curriculum, so it's just a matter of the things that students consume in the classroom and replacing those. The institutional expenses, we were able to refinance the mortgage that Whittier Christian pays for, and that should save us a reasonable amount of money. And the only capital expense we're looking at is some computers for the business office. We've been very fortunate that our PTFs have been providing the money for technology for our classrooms. They gave all of the K-8 teachers iPads last year and are planning to put an iPad card at each campus, but that all comes from fundraising and from PTF. But PTFs, for some reason, don't want to fundraise for the business office. That's just a cost of doing business. So we have to budget those, and it's really time to replace those. As we do more and more on the internet, our finances, our accounting, our school attendance, all of that is internet-based, so we become more reliant on technology. We have to be more reliant in ensuring that those programs are available. You know, I gave you quite a long handout, and I don't want to necessarily read through all of those. We're currently at a surplus for next year of $156,000, but frankly, the principals and I are working very hard to get that up to $200,000. We know that we have a deficit from this year, and we're carrying a deficit from last year. We have to overcome those and have some room for error, because while we may set employment agreements and staff at the beginning of the year, we know families come and go, and we want to be faithful stewards, but it takes God in his infinite wisdom to provide us with the right discernment so that we can see what to cut. If you go to graduation, you say, how can we do without these things? You watch those kids walk across the platform and you hand them their diplomas. You see the kindergartners talk about what they want to be when they grow up. And then we come to the facts and figures and say, well, it's a ministry, but you know, it is a business. And we've got to figure out how to run this ministry as a business and be cost effective. So that's the budget I have for you. And the basics that go along with it. So I'm happy to answer questions. after this service. I'm also happy if you want to come in and see me, and if you want to know more exactly how each program, each campus breaks down, I'd be glad to show you the detailed budget of that. Thank you.
Okay, Pastor Dennis will now present the church budget for next year.
You'll notice on our projected income, what you're seeing up there on the screen is last year's budget compared to the proposed budget. What you have in your hand is the actual from last year, which is where we derived this year's proposed budget. So we took our actual income from this last year and adopted that as our proposed budget. That is a change, reduction of over $10,000 in our expected income for this particular fiscal year. That's reflecting the offerings that we are receiving for this year. Expenses are also based off of what we actually spent last year, and we have made some reductions this year in order to meet the expected reduced income on our expenses, and you can see where those are taking place. Most of them, the $10,615, is a reduction in salaries. We're two interns less than we had last year. We had a reduction in benefits. Our senior pastor, John, is now with the Medicaid. So that Medicare, that's the one. New one of those things. So that is a reduction for us. And you can see the other reductions there. In our program, it shows that we have a 33% reduction, but that's only equivalent to $1,700. So the percentage is high, but the actual reduction is not all of that, not all that high. You'll notice this year we have put in a reserve figure in case the offerings aren't what we expect them to be, or we run into extra expense, as always happens. And you'll also notice that the missionaries are remaining the same. So the bottom line is that our proposed budget and our expenses zero out. So it's a zero-based budget. Last year shows that it says last year actual $12,259 in the red. You have to remember that when we're doing budgets, I do them on the 10th month of the fiscal year. So we have to do some number gymnastics. We take the number that we have, divide it by 10, and multiply it by 12 so that we average it out over the year. Currently, as of the last month fiscal, or the last month's end, year to date, we were only $5,500 in the red. So we're not $12,000, and we're looking forward to this month being really close to equal, depending, of course, we got this Sunday and next Sunday for the income, and we have been holding out on expenses. So that's the CBC budget.
Okay, are there any questions in regards to those presentations? You all have a ballot, hopefully. I'd like you to mark your ballot to whether you accept yes or no on that. And also on the ballot, we have one write-in. It's a election of a person to the school commission, Rich Nolan. Rich, would you stand up, please? He's He's agreed to join the school commission and help in that governance course. So thank you, Rich. So please write him in with a yes or a no also. Is there any other questions? Ralph, would you pick up? Pass your ballots into the center aisle and Ralph will pick them up for us. One last question, is there anything else to come needs to be handled this morning? In that case, we'll close the meeting with prayer. Thank you. Our Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for this, again, for this beautiful day. Thank you for the opportunity we have to serve you. And I pray now, Heavenly Father, that our votes and our actions will show honor to you and to you only. These things I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Thank you all for sticking around.